Good morning. Good morning. On this nice, bright, sunny morning, we welcome any visitors who are worshipping with us this morning, whether here in person or watching online, and we also welcome Mike Goss and Gavin Berry, who are leading worship with us this morning. Please join us for tea and coffee in Panbride Hall after worship. Here are this morning's intimations. Coffee and chat in Carnoustie Church in Dundee Street on Monday the 25th from 10 o'clock until midday for a £2 minimum donation, and this is in aid of Carnoustie Church Project Fund. Coffee and chat is on here in Panbride Hall on Wednesday the 27th of November from 10 until 11. And also on Wednesday the 27th, from 2:15 to 3:30, there is Musical Memories in Panbride Hall. And Carlogi Cafe is on in Panbride Hall on Friday the 29th of November from 10 until 11:30. Please come and support the Primary Sixes of Carlogi Primary School. The Christmas Coffee Morning next Saturday the 30th of November from 10 o'clock until 11:30 in Panbride Hall. And tickets are £3 and are available from Mary Bushnell or from me. Proceeds go towards the running costs of the defibrillator. And if you have a donation of bags or parcels to the value of a pound or more, you can give them to any member of the committee or be brought along to the hall between 4 and 5 on Friday the 29th. Or you could phone Marion Palmer or Joyce Brown, and their contact details are on the back of the order of service. The service of Remembrance and Hope in Newton Church on Sunday the 1st of December at 4 o'clock. This is an informal service which lasts around half an hour and offers the opportunity to remember a loved one in a time of quiet reflection and music, followed by tea, coffee and a mince pie for those who would like to stay, and all are welcome to this. The Advent Bible study begins next Sunday, the 1st of December, in Carnoustie Manse, 44 Terrace Road, between 7 and 8 o'clock, and this year it is about women of the Nativity. And it's on begins next Sunday the 1st, and then the 8th, the 15th, and the 22nd. And all are welcome to that. And a few intimations which are not on the order of service. We're looking for donations of mince pies and shortbread for the extra services over the Christmas period. The finance team is looking for someone for the role of free will offering convener. If you are interested, please see me or Annette for more information. And finally, the BB Postbox is once again back in the vestibule for your Christmas cards, and more information will be about that later. Any pastoral issues this week to the manse, and the phone number for that is also in the back of the order of service. I'll now ask Mike to lead us in worship this morning.
Many thanks, Lynn. I'm good to be here among you as we share in worship together as part of Carnoustie Trinity. It's our pulpit exchange, so I made Annette get up early this morning to be in Barry for the 9:30 service. And awful glad that George was able to be there to help with the computer in Barry, because we were running out of folk to look after that this morning. Can I add to that plea that we're looking for a free will offering convener? It sounds very posh, that, but actually it's mainly about receiving a batch of envelopes once a year and making sure that it goes to the right district, getting some labels to put on them and so on. So it's not a big job, but it would make it an awful lot easier if we could find somebody to do that particular job rather than lumber some of the folk who are already doing three jobs with that one as well. In Colossians we read, "Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died. Your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory." So let's sing to his praise. Our opening hymn is number 457. The first tune, Miles Lane. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. I'd like to introduce to you Gavin Berry. Gavin has been at work in the community around Dundee and Angus for many years now. You were working, first of all, with Scripture Union, and then you were an MDS with the Church of Scotland, first in Arbroath, Olden Abbey, and then in Lochee and Camperdown. So you've done a fair amount of work with the church already, but now you're here to do something else. What are you doing with me?
That's a very good question, isn't it? And I'll give the diplomatic answer. I've now retired. I've taken early retirement. I know you were thinking it, but just to confirm your suspicions. And in my retirement, it was my plan to serve the church in some kind of capacity. And well, you know that God's got a good sense of humour, and I'm now a reader in training, so that's the new job that I hope to do. But of course, as the name would suggest, there are certain hoops to jump through, tests to complete, and also practical experiences, as I'm having with the minister for the next 6 months.
So, yes, you're stuck with me for the next 6 months. What a challenge that's going to be. I'll not say who to. I'm looking forward to having you with us, Gavin. I've met you before in a number of different spheres, so we're not strangers to each other, and delighted to have you with us. No. But that's not the whole of your working life, SU, and working with the church. What did you do before you started that?
Oh, no, Mike, it was going so well. Boys and girls, if you could just close your ears. I used to be a teacher. But I saw the light.
It's all right, you can listen.
I was a secondary school teacher. Yeah, if that makes any difference. Yeah, yeah.
And what was your subject?
J'ai enseigné le français und ich habe auch Deutsch unterrichtet.
What?
And if you understand anything there, you'll know that one of them was French and one of them was German. So I was a French and German teacher. Yeah.
Modern languages, yeah.
And they got the Dundonian for free.
So, welcome, Gavin, and it's good to have you with us. And I'm going to pass over to you because you're now going to have a wee word with the young folk this morning.
Yeah, well, listen, it's lovely to be here. And in fact, it's such a treat. You know, when Mike, the minister, said to me, could you do the children's talk? I thought he meant like an all-age talk because that's kind of the way things are these days. But in fact, he had to emphasize the fact that there's young people here, real boys and girls. And I'm so excited at that because I don't think I've seen a young person certainly not in Lochee for some time since COVID. And, you know, it's just so good to be here and to have these young folks with me. But boys and girls, just before I start, you told me some of your names and that was great. And you told me some of the schools that you went to. I think it was it Burnside? Was it Woodside? And was it Woodland, and Kerlogie. But which one of those three is the best? I think, Erin, just with the face that you've got there, when you said that, I wouldn't mess with you. So is it Kerlogie you're saying is the best? Right, but I'm sure the other two are fantastic as well. Well, listen, today is a really special day in the church. And I wonder, when we say children and kids and all that kind of thing, we mean from their age right up to the oldest kid sitting in the church. So if the very young people can't get the answer this morning, can I encourage the rest of you who feel young at heart just to shout it out, because we're not in school, right? I'm not a teacher anymore. I won't give you lines, and I certainly won't give you the strap, because that's long time gone. So it's a special day in the church. It's a special Sunday. Does anybody amongst the young people first know what it's called? Charlie. Wow, did you hear that? Could you say that again? Christ the King Sunday. Fantastic. I wish I was allowed to give sweeties out, but I'm not these days. I have to eat them all myself, as you can tell. Christ the King Sunday, or sometimes we call it the reign of Christ the King. Now, that word King is in there. And this morning, I'm sure that the minister is going to be helping us think about Jesus being the greatest King of all kings. But for this next part, I do actually need a young person or a young at heart person to come out and help me and be a king for me. Now, Tom, I know that you were keen to do that. Give him a round of applause.
He's not been here 5 minutes and already he's moving the furniture around.
Now, Tom, that is fantastic. Take a seat and do your best to look kingly. Yeah? Does he look kingly? What's missing? A crown. Did somebody remember to bring one? No? Oh, wait a minute. I've got one. You're going to like this one, Tom. Just give me a minute. The gold on this king and this crown is inflatable. Now, fantastic. Now be very careful with this, Tom. It's very expensive. Very expensive. Right now.
I'm sure Charles would have preferred that one when he was said.
Does that make him look a bit more like a king now? That's good. Well, listen, the crown on his head, that tells us that he's the king. And it kind of symbolises that the king has power, and what we might say, authority over the people. So if Tom told us to do something, we would have to do it. And if he told us not to do something, then we'd have to stop doing whatever it was. Isn't that the case, Tom? Yeah. Now, boys and girls, this is for you. Where do kings usually live? In a palace. What's that?
Palace.
In a palace. Is your palace big, Tom? Yes.
Medium sized one.
It's a medium sized one. Kings usually live in a palace, don't they? And who does the king have to help him do all the different jobs that need doing in the palace? Rudy, can you think of who that might be? The queen. That's a fantastic answer, but you need to go straight to jail for that one. Well, you're right, like a butler, but he would have lots of different people that they would call. Some of the big kids can shout it out. Oh, Charlie? Did you say women? Servants. Thank goodness for that. Servants, yeah. Oh, I was going to get my coat. Servants. So we all have all these servants, and nowadays servants get paid. But back in the day, I don't think they did. Isn't that right, Tom? Yeah. But listen, how can the king afford to live in a palace and have all these servants? How can he afford that? Any ideas? He's got lots of money. Have you got lots of money, King Tom?
Loads of money.
That's great. See Tom afterwards if you're looking for a sub. Now, when Jesus was on the earth 2,000 years ago, would you say that he lived like this kind of king? Even though he was called the king, that was one of the names that was given to Jesus. King of Kings. Yes? No? No. Of course he didn't. He didn't live in a palace, did he? He didn't wear a crown. He didn't have lots of money. And he certainly didn't have servants. Although he did have friends, didn't he, that followed him. Do you remember them? 12 of them. What were they called? I don't need the actual names, but together, thank you. But they were all called the disciples, that's right. So Jesus didn't have all that money. In fact, he was born not in a palace, but in a stable, that's right. His parents didn't have lots of money, they were actually quite poor. But Jesus was a special kind of king. We call him the servant king because he came from God to show us and to tell us that being a king, being the best kind of king or queen, is all about looking after and caring for and loving your people. Now, we know that many people didn't like Jesus and they decided to get rid of him. And in fact, they killed him, didn't they? And he went back to heaven just 3 days after he came back to life. Well, he didn't stay dead. But then in the course of time, he went back to heaven to be with his Father. And today we're remembering that the servant king Jesus, not only that he is a different kind of king, but also it's that he's going to come back one day. And he's going to come back not looking like Tom, who is looking pretty special just now, but he's going to come back looking even more stunning as the King of Kings. When he comes back to claim his kingdom here on earth and to see who will join him in that amazing kingdom of love and light. So I suppose I've only got one question to ask everybody, and that is, when Jesus comes back, or even just thinking about that, would you like to be in his kingdom? I'll tell you why I would, because he is the kindest, most generous, and most loving king that there is. Will you remember that? That's Jesus, the servant king. Thank you, Tom. And as you go back to your seat, I think we can give you a wee round of applause. Well, boys and girls, young and old, let's just think about that as I say a short prayer for us, shall we? Loving God and Heavenly Father, thank you that you sent your Son, Jesus, to tell us and to show us what it's like to be a king. Thank you that Jesus is the best king, the greatest king. And thank you that he loves us just the way we are. And thank you for Christmas that approaches and reminds us of all that Jesus is and all that he has done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Right, folks, we're going to sing a new hymn next. And so I'm going to teach it to you. And I'm going to start by teaching you the chorus. So if we can get the words of the chorus up on the screen. King of Heaven. There's nothing like throwing something at the tech team just at the last minute. They're not expecting it. King of Heaven, we will answer the call. We will follow, bringing hope to the world. No, it's gone past. Filled with passion, filled with power to proclaim salvation in Jesus' name. So Jesus, our King of Heaven, is the one who calls us into his kingdom. Now, it's quite a straightforward chorus. That's why I'm teaching you it just now. It goes, King of Heaven, we will answer the call. Give me that back. King of Heaven, we will answer the call. We will follow, bringing hope to the world. We will follow, bringing hope to the world. Filled with passion, filled with power to proclaim. Filled with passion, filled with power to proclaim. Salvation in Jesus' name. Salvation in Jesus' name. So you hear how that goes? It's quite straightforward. You ready to sing that together? Let's give that one a go and we'll get some accompaniment which will put us into the right key. Wasn't bad. Oh, that's great. So let's just sing the chorus together. Because we'll need to go straight into verse 2. It's verse 1, verse 2, chorus, verse 3, chorus. So we'll all sing together verse 2, but we'll let the choir lead us in verse 1. You'll get the idea of how the verses go. Let's sing, Hear the Call of the Kingdom.
Thank you.
just while the young folk, I think, are going out. Is that right? They're going out just now. And as you go, I'll be telling folks about where that hymn has come from. So just carry on and head out. The hymn we've just sung comes from God Welcomes All, which is the new supplement the Church of Scotland has produced for the hymn book. And I hope that we'll be able to introduce a few more of these in our various churches over the coming year. We've begun to look at one or two of them in Carnoustie and in Barry. I hope you'll be able to share some as well. But I thought that was a great one to start with, didn't you? Oh, good. So pleased for that. Our opening prayers now and the Lord's Prayer are going to be led by Gavin. I want to check, do you do debts and debtors here? Yes.
Good.
That's what I told them.
Well, let's come before God now with our prayer, shall we? Let's join our hearts together. Almighty God, we give you thanks for this beautiful Sabbath day that you have made and commanded us to set aside for rest and worship. We thank you that we can meet together in this comfortable place in freedom and peace to worship you without fear of persecution or death, as is sadly the case for so many Christian brothers and sisters around the world today. Lord, in our inability to protect them from evil, we pray that you would be the source of refuge and strength today. And as we come into your holy presence, Lord, we confess that we've done and said things over the past week that have offended and grieved not only other people, but you, our loving Heavenly Father. Lord, we make no excuses for our behavior and no false promises to turn away from the sins that would beset us. Instead, we point to him who has dealt with our sin problem once and for all time when he died on the cross in our place at Calvary. And we ask your forgiveness in his precious name. We thank you for the risen Lord Jesus, who not only makes us right with you, but who at this very moment intercedes for us before your glorious throne of mercy and grace, where day and night the angels praise you as they sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. For you are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." So, Father God, just like the angels in heaven, enable us to praise you and worship you this day as we ought. For we ask it in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to say these words: "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, for ever. Amen."
Our first reading is from Psalm 93, and this can be found on page 601 of the Pew Bibles. Psalm 93. The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and armed with strength. Indeed, the world is established, firm and secure. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. Your statues, Lord, stand firm. Holiness adorns your house for endless days. Amen. Our next hymn is number 57, The Lord Doth Reigneth. Our second reading is from Revelations chapter 1, and this you can find on page 1233 of the Pew Bibles. Prologue. The revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw. That is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. Greetings and doxology. From John. To the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us, and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom, and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all peoples on earth will mourn mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. John's vision of Christ. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp, double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore what you have seen, and what is now, and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Thank you, Joyce, for sharing God's word with us this morning. As we consider God's word together, let's begin in prayer. Let's pray. Father, you are the only one who can truly teach us. Help us to hear your voice through the preaching of your word, that we may know what you are saying to us this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I don't know about you, but there are times when I wake up in the morning and as soon as I'm awake, my head is just full of the day ahead. Things to do, things to plan, all sorts of things cramming in there, creating so much noise and confusion. Sometimes my head's just full of mush. Yours ever like that? Well, I suspect so sometimes. And then there are times when I wake up and the first thing I think was, what was that dream again? As something seemed to have been so vivid and clear in my head moments before I'd opened my eyes, and it vanishes like that. Dreams that are gone before I can get the picture, before I can try to work out what do they mean. Sometimes it's those dreams where you're falling or running about naked, and they usually mean one thing. You've got too many things on and you're just stressed out. I hope that's not your experience just now, Gavin, as you're trying to get all those different things prepared for your assignments this week. And then I told him he had to preach as well. So, yes, too many things. That can happen in all our different circumstances, and especially when the panto's on for some of the folk here. Yes? Yes? Yeah, definitely. That panic sensation, that lets our subconscious start dreaming away all of that panic, that frustration. Other times the dreams have just no idea what they're about and why they were there. But we find in the Bible that in the sovereignty of God, he chooses to speak to his servants through dreams from time to time. Pictures that are not just fleeting impressions gone on the break of day, but that are so persistent, they remain and are remembered strongly and powerfully. Images that point to the reality of the things that are and the things that shall be. And so we find in the scriptures many dreams and visions described at various times. And they come from the Lord, who reveals his purposes to and through his servants. Sometimes we don't even know what form the dreams took. You know the story of the wise men? They are warned in a dream about Herod's plans, and so they don't go back to Herod after seeing Jesus born. But other times we get quite a bit of detail to those dreams. There's the dreams that Joseph interprets right through Genesis. Again and again we hear what the picture was, and then the interpretation, its meaning. What is it saying to us? And the first thing that we learn from the way that God uses these dreams is that God is in control. He holds the future in his hands. The world is his, and nothing is hidden from him. So if we listen to his voice, he will direct our paths. That's quite an important message when we start reading the book of Revelation in particular. Because the vast bulk of the dream of the book is a dream or vision that John has when he's in exile on the island of Patmos. A vision of God, yes, but also a vision of the world in chaos, in terror. And sometimes these visions are used to make spectacular films of Armageddon and all the rest of it. But actually, they very often miss, in all of these films and books, the whole point of the vision in the first place. Because the vision starts and finishes and punctuates throughout at regular intervals with the one central message that God is on the throne. That's why we begin here with the vision of the risen and glorified Christ. And why we will end when we get to the end of Revelation with the vision of all things made new and God on his throne and his people with him. And this echoes again and again in the book of Revelation. And if we get caught up in the images of chaos and start trying to identify too closely what that particular beast or that particular picture refers to, other than Donald Trump. No, I didn't say that. But if we try and do that too closely, we'll actually miss the point of the vision itself. Because the vision of Revelation was not given so that you and I can work out what's happening in 21st century America on its own. Nor so that the people of John's time could work out what was happening in Rome in the first century AD. The point was to look at the whole systems of the world in their chaos and confusion, and know that God is still on the throne. That's really important for us to keep hold of, because we live in a world where chaos seems to be king, where foreign powers so often seem to make the running, driving the agenda of our politics, of our lives, and of all that's going on. We live in a world that's all shook up, as an old guy once said. The message of Revelation is God is on the throne. What's going to happen in Ukraine? Missiles being chucked more and more powerfully between there and Russia. My answer? I have no idea. I don't know. What will happen with Israel and Lebanon and the Middle East and the tinderbox that seemed to be lighting up there? I don't know. But what I do know is the message of Revelation, the message of Scripture as a whole. God is on the throne. Christ is King. He is the Lord of heaven and earth. And in spite of all that happens in the world around us, in our daily lives with the chaos we face, still He reigns. And that should give us confidence. Because when we look at the world, human systems are always prone to failure, to making a mess of things. I've heard it suggested the best person to rule a country is the one who least wants to do it. Who's best qualified to be president or prime minister or king? The one who doesn't want the job in the first place. It just so happens that you never end up with that person because of the way our systems work. Was it Winston Churchill who said, "Democracy is the worst possible system of government, apart from all the other options that we've tried"? And it is true, because all of our systems are messed up, and in different ways, they fail. Oh, I nearly got into saying why and how they have failed in our own country, but I better not go down that road, or I might be heard as suggesting the one particular party gets it wrong more than another. I'm not persuaded that that is the case. We all mess up, and they do too. And some start with good intent, but often even they find themselves corrupted by the very nature of power itself. The desire for more power, for extending that. The very nature grabs at us, our human desire for more control and power and wealth in itself. No system is perfect, although that doesn't mean we have an excuse for abandoning our part in them all. Democracy actually means that the people are king. And that gives you and I a huge responsibility to think about when it comes to election times and all of those things. But in all that we face in the chaos of the world, as it is now, as it might be in the future, Christ is on the throne. It's His rule and reign that will finally outlast the rest. Human kingdoms have their way for a time. Different authorities come and go. Different parties are in government in our own land. Different systems. What we have now is the government of the United Kingdom is very different from the way it was before Oliver Cromwell fomented revolution. We think the Restoration put it back to the way it was. It didn't. Parliamentary democracy would follow on. A kind of democracy that was never enjoyed by our nation prior to that revolution. Change is inevitable. Change of government, of ways of being, of doing, of laws that are made and laws that are changed. And we wonder what comes next. But in the end, Christ is on the throne. I remember in my teens and 20s, some of you will remember those times as well. That was the times of the Cold War. I couldn't imagine the fall of the Soviet Empire. It seemed completely unrealistic to think that would ever end. But it did fall. The Berlin Wall came down. What a change that has made to Europe. And while Putin and the oligarchs have taken over Mother Russia and threatened to try and extend their influence once more over Eastern Europe, it's never going to be the same again as it once was when we were young. Christ is on the throne. Another election has gone by in the United States. And one of the things that has greatly disturbed me is what I would call the great folly of the American evangelical right, for they have aligned themselves with Donald Trump. They've stretched for an earthly power, but they haven't recognized the danger of that power holding on to them. The danger is that when we grasp at earthly power, we will lose to that power. But Christ is on the throne. It would be the same error were we to align ourselves with any political party or person or individual, because it is not a party that can bring out the best in our nations. It is not a person who will make a country great again or otherwise. And we need to remember that Christ is on the throne. We take our place in our modern democracy, in the votes and all the rest of it. But all of this is secondary to our primary purpose as God's people. We serve in His kingdom for His glory. Not for our nation to be great, but for His rule to be cleared over all the nations. The ultimate goal of our Lord is not that we remake a British empire or an American one, nor even a Russian or Chinese one. No, His goal is to make a new kingdom, already working subversively in the nations of the world today. It's why in many of these lands, like Russia and China, those who speak for the truth of the kingdom are often oppressed, imprisoned, beaten, and even killed for that fact. But Christ is on the throne. As we come to the end of the church year, we celebrate again this great theme: the reign of Christ, the coming of His kingdom. It is the reminder that in all of the story of the scriptures, old and new, Christ is on the throne, is our theme, is our message, and is our everlasting hope. This is what He purposes for the nations. This is what He purposes for you and I. That psalm we read from earlier, Psalm 93, I wonder if you spotted that we got it twice this morning. Did you? Because immediately after we sang it, the earth belongs unto the Lord. The Lord doth reign. That's the other one of the psalms, to Stroudwater, I got in my head for a moment. The Lord doth reign, and clothed with He is He. The same psalm that speaks of the rule of God there in the Old Testament. A rule that is in the face of the chaos of the world. When we sang those words again, I thought it was just like Carnoustie yesterday. The seas have lifted up their voice, the waters roaring make, but the Lord is on His throne. The sea is contained. It is calmed again. Who is in charge in our lives? It has to be Christ. It has to be His rule and reign we seek. And that has to be what we long for and labor for in our lives today. Next Sunday, we start the Christian year once more. We look forward to Advent. Advent, not the preparation for Christmas, but Advent, the preparation for our Savior and His glorious return, to make all things new, to restore His creation, to reign over all. Are you ready for the coming of His kingdom? Let us make that our task, our promise, and our great hope. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, there are times when we fear for the state of the world around us, when we worry about what is going on in different parts of that world, or even in the chaos of our own lives. But you are the same God, whose plan and purpose is good and gracious. Help us to trust in your reign, to look and serve your kingdom, and so to glorify Christ, our Saviour and our God. In his name we pray. Amen. The throne of God, the place of our security and our great hope. The hymn is number 466, Before the Throne of God Above. So, most gracious Father, we bring you our thank offerings this day. Gifts we have brought here in this place. Gifts that we have given by other means for your church's work. Receive then these gifts and our very lives in your service. And use all for your glory and your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Tyrants there are across the world who set themselves up as dictators and kings. They have different titles. Sometimes they call themselves president, even in some countries, prime minister, and yet they wield a power that should not be theirs. We pray for the nations, for the reign of Christ, and for his glory and kingdom. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we do indeed pray for the nations of this earth, riven by war, violence, and hatred. We pray for your peace, the peace that comes with the advance of your kingdom into the hearts and minds of those in authority and who seek to lead. We pray for places such as Russia and Ukraine, the suffering that is there, the horror of war. We pray for the land you called holy, the land of Israel, and the terrible destruction being wrought in Gaza and in Lebanon today. And for those who seek to impose power by terrible destruction, by the death of the innocents, we pray that you would stay their hand and prevent their ways, that the reign of your peace might come. It's a prayer for many other lands too, such as Myanmar and Sudan and other places across the earth where warfare and struggle prevail. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. And so break the power of those who seek their own glory and count not the cost in the lives of others. Bring instead your glorious kingdom of peace and justice. Our gracious Father, we pray also for our own nation, for His Majesty King Charles and the royal family, and all those who seek to govern us in Westminster and Holyrood and in our local authority. May they seek your will and be guided by your wisdom, that rather than earthly power, they would discover the true grace of your power that brings humility and service and life for those most in need in the world around us. And we pray for your church, most gracious Lord. Remembering the Church of England in its time of trial, in the awful of things that have been revealed these past weeks, we pray that there true repentance and peace would be found, restoration for those who've been treated badly, victims of abuse of so many kinds. And here in Scotland, in the Church of Scotland in particular, we pray for our own humility to recognize where we have failed and fallen and allowed abuse to take place among our own people. Teach us how to care, to serve, to seek out what is good and right and true, and to build up those who have been broken. And we pray especially for the church here in our own community. We thank you for all that we gain from our partnership together in our new union in Carnoustie Trinity and with other congregations of your church in this town, all a part of your one holy body. Help us to learn how to serve each other, to care for and with each other, to reach out to the community around us with the love planted in our hearts, and to seek ever the advancement of your kingdom among young and old, male and female, all peoples in our community and beyond. And so we pray particularly for those who have special need of your grace, your healing, and your comfort this day. We think of those who have suffered grief and loss and ask that you would be near to them to console and comfort with the hope you've given us in your Son Jesus, with the life that is eternal in him. We think of those who are struggling with illness and frailty of both body or mind, that they too would all know your healing strength, your hope for tomorrow, your help for each day. And we pray for each other as we think of those around us, in front and behind, on our right, on our left, above us in the balcony, on each side, in our side aisles. Thank you for each other. Be with us all to strengthen our service and love for you and your body, that all we do and say might be to your glory and for the sake of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Christ, our King. Christ, our great hope. Christ, our security. Surely we would crown him with all our praise and worship and our being. Our closing hymn is number 439. Look, ye saints, the sight is glorious. See the man of sorrows now from the fight. Return victorious. Every knee to him shall bow. Number 439. Forevermore.